Hello, my friends. We're going to talk about the full moon in Sagittarius. It's happening at 23 degrees of the sign, of the archer, of the centaur, of the traveler, of the journeyer, the seeker, the explorer, the one who goes on pilgrimage, the one who is a philosopher, a sage, a wise person, the one who gets out into the world, goes beyond the bounds of one's own local community, one's own backyard, and explores the world, and therefore develops a more broad-minded, culturally diverse outlook on the world. And we all have Sag somewhere. So those of you who have Sag sun, Sag moon, you'll have this much more strongly, Sag rising, etc. But we all have Sagittarius somewhere in our charts. So you can look for where that is in your chart. You look for that symbol with the arrow, and you can see where that exists in your chart. So you'll know where this full moon happens in your chart. Okay, if you haven't subscribed to this channel, please consider doing so if you want to make sure you are privy to these every 2 weeks. I do one for the new moon and one for the full moon at this time. And also my Patreon, I post a weekly post for the astrology for the week, and I go really in depth with things there, okay, along with my art, poetry, all things themed dark goddess. That's where we do all that kind of stuff. So I'd love to include you in that community. So this moon's conjunct Medusa, the asteroid Medusa, which makes it a pretty intense, that serpent energy, that serpent wisdom, that goddess wisdom of the serpent. And that exists within all of us. We all have kundalini energy, the coiled serpent at the base of the spine. You're not going to see that on an MRI, right? But it's there. And that serpent can rise up through our energetic system and meet the base of our skull, right? Go up the spine and meet the mind. And when that happens, we have these peak experiences. And there's, of course, whole traditions that revolve around that energy, or that include that energy, that are much more complex than this reading is going to be able to address. But that's one of the basics, right? So this serpent energy, we all have access to that because it lives in each and every one of our bodies. This wisdom of that's direct gnosis or knowing divinity that we each have. And that when we raise our consciousness, we can achieve a connection to the divine on our own without anybody else being involved in that, through our connection with nature, our connection with our bodies. I mean, we're always connected to nature. Everything is natural. There's nothing there. That dividing line is kind of false, but we know when we're in a space that is less interfered with by human, the ways we want to organize things to make things good for ourselves, at least in the short term, right? When we're in those kind of spaces, like a forest or a beach, that we're alone in those kind of spaces by a river, we can feel our energy centers and our bodies sort of recalibrating, getting reorganized. We can get grounded. We can feel connected to what actually is instead of what we're thinking about in the past and the future, you know, in our minds. So it reduces anxiety. And there's a reason for that. You know, it's because we're connecting back to that earth wisdom. So that wisdom of the serpent, there is hostility toward that in a world that doesn't want us to have that direct access, right? In a world that wants there to be a hierarchy of power and is uncomfortable with the change that serpent, the symbol of the serpent, symbolizes. That constant shedding of skins and the vulnerability that comes along with that shedding of skins, when a snake sheds a skin, that snake, it's at least my understanding that the snake goes blind for a while, and that skin underneath is very tender. So there's a lot of vulnerability to change. You know, there's a symbol of the Ouroboros, which has to do with the cycles of change, right? The serpent eating its own tail. And there's many, 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 many stories of a hero vanquishing the serpent or the dragon to bring order to the world. So the serpent is often seen as a symbol of the divine feminine, and the divine feminine being equated with chaos and evil, right? So we want to rectify that. We want to bring that back into holiness, right? Because that's going to bring more balance. Medusa, her story is very sad, like a lot of the stories of the vanquished serpent, like the story of Lilith, like the stories of dragons that are killed. When you look at it from a different perspective, when you look at it from the perspective of night wisdom, when you look at it from the perspective of witchcraft wisdom, right, walking the serpent path, it's a sadder story. It's not a story of victory over darkness and chaos. It's a story of suppression and colonization and murder and really ugly things. And so Medusa was vilified. She was once considered to be stunningly beautiful and had great power because of that beauty. And that beauty was more than just physical beauty. It had to do with the beauty of the goddess, the energy of the divine feminine. And she was, there's a lot of different layers to her story throughout history. She's a goddess in her own right, but she's also a priestess of Athena, another goddess who Athena in later stories has a lot of antagonism and hatred toward her own femininity and toward the femininity of other beings, and tended to champion the hero. So she's very much a patriarchal goddess, and that may be for her own survival, right? That's why any of us do that. And so Poseidon, Neptune, who is also part of this full moon, the moon's in a square with Neptune, god of the sea. Poseidon and Medusa are said to lay together. And it's a way to put it. And because Athena is a virgin goddess, she sees that as a defilement of her temple. And she exiles Medusa to the, you know, ends of the earth, which is so often what happens to these feminine beings who represent that serpent, who are symbolized by that serpent energy. And again, that's not that that femininity isn't something that's owned exclusively by women. This is something that exists within all of us, right? And all of us have different takes on what gender means and what gender, you know, the energies of gender is that even an energy, etc. But for the purposes of my getting this story across to you, I'm talking about it in the ways that I am. So Medusa is exiled, and she's said to have serpents. Her hair becomes serpents, and her face becomes hideous, and it turns men to stone. Right? Now, in some versions of the myth, she's so exceptionally beautiful that she overpowers. Right? So, but in this story, it gets twisted. And Athena, not satisfied with having her out there on, you know, on the edges of the earth, sends the hero Perseus to execute her. And he does so, and he decapitates her and destroys her power. So Medusa is then kept on Athena's shield that she uses for war. She uses that face of the outraged, violated feminine. She turns it around to use to weaponize. She puts it over her breastplate also. It's can be she's seen with that as well, over her heart, which is very interesting to me. It shows grief. It shows like this is, you know, that she knows, or what's the words I'm looking for? Athena and Medusa could be said to be two faces of the same being. And with these stories, there's the historical side to it. There's the history of and what we find in source materials, but there's also the interpretations that we make, the ways that it affects us today. Both of these things are relevant. Okay. So, it's a sad story. However, Medusa is incredibly powerful, and we know that because we're still talking about her. Her stories, she appears in a lot of different places in the ancient Greek writings, and that was a long time ago. And we still have her. She shows up in popular culture in various ways. People still dress as Medusa for Halloween, right? She has this immense erotic and dark and intense power to her. So we still know deep down what she is. There's part of us, even if we're not familiar with these stories, she represents something. We know it. We can feel it in our bones, right? We can feel it in our souls that she's more than just the story, that there's something very powerful about her, and that we still want to access that power. So this full moon, she is a major player in this. And so with Sagittarius representing philosophy, it may be a call for us to reevaluate some of the things that we believe. That we believe about ourselves, that we believe about the feminine, that we believe about victims, the way we villainize, what we believe about shadow, what we hold in our own shadow, in our own psyches. The shadow is where we put things that we're uncomfortable with. Not even just uncomfortable, but where we put aspects of our psychology that we feel threaten our survival in some way. So if we see that when we're going through the world, or when we watch, we witness what happens to other people, when we see that femininity equals victimization, what are we going to do with that energy? We're going to shove it down, right? We're going to put that in the shadow. And there's a lot of tricky ways that we can do that. We can appear to be embracing it in this way or that way, but there's certain aspects of it we're going to keep over here, like vulnerability, you know, or really feeling things deeply. Those kinds of things that we can see as a weakness. And in a patriarchal society, it's seen as a weakness. We're going to put that in shadow. And then when we see somebody else exhibiting those qualities that we don't like about ourselves, we might feel like attacking them, right? We might feel like villainizing them. And that's what Athena does, right? So we have this dynamic going on with this full moon that's playing out here. So we need to be active and conscious and brave in how we approach this energy. And we need to be committed to our own healing and to collective healing. We need to be willing to explore the shadow. We need to be willing to explore vulnerability with discernment, of course. Don't just be vulnerable with it. Not everyone's entitled to your story, okay? You don't have to tell your story to anybody. No one's entitled to it. This can be something you do on your own, and when you're ready, if you're ever ready, if you ever want to, you can share about what's what for you. Okay, so Medusa represents both power and outrage, and the way that the power of that serpent energy gets twisted around and fucked up and murdered. But also, guess what? Serpents are about regeneration. So you can kill the serpent and it's going to come back. And that's what's happened with witchcraft, right? Witchcraft is said to be, in some traditions, walking the serpent path, the crooked path. How many times has witchcraft been suppressed? How many people have been burned at the stake and hung and tortured? And, you know, now it's all 21st century style. It's by vilifying somebody online, right? And that's not a defense of anybody who is doing anything actually abusive, by the way. That's twisted around, too. People say it's a witch hunt when they're not the persecuted one. But just to say that. But, you know, this has been suppressed. This magic has been suppressed again and again and again. And yet it reemerges all the time because that's the nature of the serpent energy. It regenerates, right? So this is something to explore. What's your relationship to this energy? Might be a question for you. Now the moon is squaring Neptune, and I just spoke to Neptune's role in that story of Medusa. In some versions of the story, Neptune is said to violate her, that it's not a willing get together, and yet she's persecuted anyway. He is, you know, gets off scot-free, and she's the one who ends up destroyed. So that's a familiar story that we see over and over again. But Neptune energy in astrology isn't necessarily villainous energy either. It's really, I don't want to say neutral because it's very powerful, but it's not about morality per se. The energy as a the symbol as a symbolic of a certain energy, right? Any more than Jupiter is. Jupiter has a lot of shitty stories too in the Greek mythology, right? But Jupiterian energy is something different. But it bears mentioning some of the stories because these planets and these energies are named for these gods, right? So they're part of our collective psyche in the Western world. So we have to sort of talk about it, right? But Neptune, beyond those stories, getting to the root, the essence of what Neptune is the energy of the sea. And it could be looked at as, basically these energies are genderless, right? Or they're genderful. They're all of it. They're the full spectrum of all of it come together. Neptune is the source of life, the source of the soul. Neptune is a transpersonal planet. So it is a planet that is more than personal, right? So it's kind of challenging for us as mere mortals to digest Neptune's energy. It's bigger than ourselves. So when a transpersonal planet is prominent in our individual chart, or it's prominent in a full moon, you know, chart, that means that there's energy that's collective being drawn into the picture, and that we're having to play out our fated role in that collective mythological story. All right. So Neptune is everything, really is one, right? That's Neptune. When we have a realization that we are connected to everything and everything is alive, I would say Neptune is indicative of animism, that everything is alive. The chair I'm sitting in is energy. The fence outside, the hills are alive. The hills are alive, right? That they are living beings. The river that runs next to my home here is a living being. That animated, everything's ensouled. These aren't objects to be used. These are living beings to be in relationship with. Neptune is considered to be a higher octave of Venus in astrology. Venus is about personal love and our enjoyment of relationships and of beauty and luxury and of the things that and of our resources and things that we value. Neptune takes that, elevates that into a more collective universal love, right? So that's at essence what the energy of Neptune is. It's quite ego dissolving. And here's where we get into the tricky part with navigating Neptune energy. Neptune, because sometimes we're not egoless most of the time. We're not egoless, right? We do things for survival reasons. We do things to enhance our own importance. We want to be relevant. And these are all, yeah, we're human, right? We want to be included. We want to feel valuable. So when an ego sort of dissolving energy comes in, we can feel anxious because it makes us feel like, uh-oh, I'm going to disappear. I'm going to get swallowed up. I'm not going to be important. I'm not going to be seen. My name's not going to mean anything, right? And so that can get us, or here's another way that this can come at us. Neptune can rule addictions because we want to go back to the womb. We want that sense of oneness. Next, Neptune can rule delusions because we're like, God spoke to me and said that I'm the chosen one. Fantastic. And we can feel sort of overblown, you know, so we can get that kind of thing going where we feel like we're called, you know, I am the voice of the country I live in or whatever, you know, sort of ego inflated as a way of sort of counterbalancing the ego dissolving of Neptune, right? So there's a lot of ways that this can get us sort of delusional, right? And Neptune can also make us feel a longing for something that we don't know what it is. We're looking for something. It's something special, something that's going to re-enchant my world, something soulful. And we can fall in love under Neptune and project things that maybe are there or maybe aren't there. So it's a tricky energy to manage in a way that is beneficial. So we have to stay grounded. That's one thing that we have to do when we're dealing with Neptune, is we have to stay grounded and let the energy pass through us instead of trying to get attached to it, instead of trying to create a story about it, trying to dam up the waters of Neptune. We have to let it flow through us. So there's a surrender to the energy. There's a fluidity to the energy to allow it to come through us and sort of wash us clean, right? So it's a wonderful energy for creativity, for connecting to the world beyond our own boundaries. It's an energy of great compassion and looking at the world through the eyes of beauty, and to remember that the world is ensouled, it is enchanted. This is a magical world full of beautiful things. And everyone matters, and love is universal, and there's a universal love energy that you can access anytime you want, and that you don't have to deserve it. You don't have to not deserve it. You know, there's no one, everybody is included. So, Neptune in a square with the Sagittarius moon can be heightened spiritual experiences, heightened experiences of knowing, maybe communicating with the land or with the spirits around you or with the gods, the goddesses, in a way that is that feels elevated and feels that's new territory, maybe, right? Or that door opens anyway. And we have the ability to do that. The sun is in Gemini right now at 23 degrees. So a full moon is always when the moon and the sun are opposite each other. So it's a moment of culmination. And it's a culmination in the sign that the moon is in, right? So it's a culmination in the energies that I talked about in the beginning of this reading of what Sagittarius represents. And so it is a sea journey of a kind. That's a way to sort of look at it, that we're on this sort of odyssey and we're out at sea and there's no land in sight for this full moon. So we have to accept the fact that we're out at sea and get what the best of that journey is going to be. So being able to travel beyond what is what is mundane, and letting the magical, the fantastical, the imaginary enter in. So there's a difference between fantasy and imagination. At least I like to say this, you know, it's something to think about, right? So it's one way to look at it, is that fantasy is great. Fantasy is best used recreationally, right? It's a wonderful thing to indulge in, but it's not a place to live, right? But imagination, now that's different. That's very active. And imagination is holy. Imagination is what makes the world, right? Imagination, sometimes when I get asked a lot by people when they're meditating or they're doing ritual, they're practicing magic, how do I know the difference between whether this is imagination, my imagination, or I'm actually hearing my guides, or I'm actually talking to the goddess, or I'm, you know, actually having a real experience, you know? And what I always say is that imagination is the method of the gods to speak to us. Like when we create art, that is magic. That is a form of magic, right? When we do a ritual and we have the feelings we have, that's magic. That is what magic is. You know, when we shift the energies, that's magic, right? So that's different. Imagination is different from fantasy, like I say, because fantasy can be, I'm the only one who hears the goddess, or I'm going to redefine what the goddess is to everyone in the world, because I have the, you know, like fantasy, we kind of know because our egos get really overblown. You know, we start to get too big, right? That's when it's really working for us, you know, to believe something. That's when we have to use our discernment and start questioning things, right? Okay. Anyway, this full moon has a lot of imagination to it and a lot of creative power and the ability to shift our beliefs a little bit and to suspend disbelief. And that's something we have to do. That's why in a ritual, when we want to do a spell, we want to create a shift. That's what the music and the incense and the candles and all the gewgaws and whatnots on the altar, that's what it's for. It's to access, there's a lot of reasons that those things are there, right? Those that be more than what I'm about to say. But one of the reasons is to shift our focus off of five senses reality, off of what's literal and mundane, and shift it off into being open and being receptive and being in a different kind of state, right? And so this full moon has that quality to it. Just getting back to the vulnerability piece, I wanted to mention that Mars and Chiron are in an exact conjunction for this full moon. And the Mars conjunction with Chiron is happening in Aries. So this is an opportunity to recognize places, again, where we feel vulnerable, where we might feel sort of unsure about how to act. Some of the surety of Mars in Aries is being challenged by Chiron. Chiron has to do with wisdom. Chiron is another centaur. So Sagittarius, the sign that the moon is in, is the symbol of the centaur shooting the arrow. Chiron is also another centaur. So centaurs invite us to connect to our instincts and connect to that deeper wisdom that we started this reading talking about. This Mars Chiron aspect, you know, is adding to some of the vulnerable feelings that we're having right now. And so if you're not sure how to act, especially with Neptune making a square to the moon, that's okay. Take a pause for a moment, you know, and breathe and feel what you're actually feeling, because there may be something coming up that you need to know about, if I just sort of react from impulse, which usually works out really well when Mars is in Aries, we can usually do that. And that's not, it's like the first feeling you have, it's usually the right one, right? Because you're recognizing what's what in your body before your mind does, and you're good. With Chiron there, it doesn't mean that that's not true still, but there, you might feel some hesitation because Chiron has to do, it's Chiron's the wounded healer. So this theme of healing comes up again. With Chiron here. See, we might feel like instead of just impulsively acting, you could be acting from a place of wounding. That's what I'm trying to just caution against. And with Neptune, it could be a little delusional because you really want to believe something that might not be really true. Oh, there's this wonderful mirage. I must go there, you know? And so it's just good to maybe pause for a beat and say, is this coming from someplace that's wounded? Is this coming from a shadow place? And this is an opportunity for me to act for my own healing rather than, you know, in a way that's violent. Because, you know, victims are the most violent people, right? So when we feel very vulnerable, sometimes we will act in a way. And when I say violent, I don't necessarily mean hitting somebody over the head with a hammer, but we can be violent with our words. We can be violent emotionally. We can be, you know, manipulative or do, you know, something shitty, right? That can cause somebody else an injury because we feel vulnerable and when somebody's pressing that into that wound, you know? So it's just, we just want to be aware, right? And take it again as an opportunity to be like, all right, what can I do for myself toward my own healing here? What action can I take for that? So that I can feel more confident in the world and more fortified as I go forward here. All right. So that's what I have to say about this full moon in Sagittarius. Take care, my friends.